It's early 2006 and the global war on terror is in its fourth year, spearheaded by the US and launched in response to the September 11th terror attacks. The war on terror now spans from the Middle East to the Philippines and even South America. The tendrils of Al-Qaeda and other affiliated terror groups have been secretly spreading across the world, all with the goal of becoming a multinational decentralized agency, capable of carrying on terror operations even if one cell is destroyed elsewhere. The expansion has been stunningly successful, and it would sadly take the deaths of thousands on September 11, 2001, to wake up politicians around the world to the cries of the intelligence agencies who have been warning them of the terror expansion for the last decade. The attacks would reverberate through Americans' daily lives, on the large scale like seeing their military fighting on foreign soil, to small inconveniences like no longer being able to bring water onto a flight. This is the story of how we got there. Inside Pakistan, the United States and Great Britain are both carrying out covert surveillance and espionage operations. Despite overtures of friendship and cooperation, the intelligence agencies of both nations warn their governments that the Pakistanis are secretly aiding and abetting Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, and other insurgent forces streaming into Afghanistan. The Pakistan government has forbidden NATO forces from carrying out offensive operations against terror networks inside the tribal mountain areas, claiming that it does not want an expansion of hostilities into its border. Secretly, though, Pakistan intelligence officers routinely coordinate the crossing of terrorists and insurgents from Pakistan's mountainous border with Afghanistan and supply arms, medical supplies, and even training. For their part, the governments of the United States and Great Britain continue to seek out the cooperation of Pakistan, who hold several key resupply routes into Afghanistan, and believe that they can sway the Pakistanis over to their side. This will prove to be a completely wrong assumption. But in the meantime, at least the US and Britain have both approved the use of covert intelligence operatives inside Pakistan, in violation of their agreements not to carry out intelligence operations inside the nation without alerting Pakistan's Inter-Service Intelligence Agency, or ISI. It's an unseasonably hot February morning in Islamabad, capital of Pakistan, when Rashid Rauf enters his usual tea house for a morning drink. A dual citizen of both Britain and Pakistan, Rauf routinely flies from England to Pakistan. With the ramping up of the war on terror, though, Rauf quickly earned himself a place on a carefully selected watch list due to his numerous ties to militant groups, some of which held very extremist views. One of those ties includes his marriage to a relative of Maulana Masood Azhar, the head and founder of Jaish-e-Mohammed, a militant terror group whose aim is to separate Kashmir from India and merge it with Pakistan. For weeks now, Rauf has been recorded meeting with representatives of various charities set up to collect donations for the victims of the 2005 Kashmir earthquake, a devastating 7.6 magnitude quake, which killed over 80,000 people. Yet some of the charities have been linked to extremist groups, and it's believed the funds are being used to fuel terror activities. The suspicions of the British agents tailing Rauf is only increased when he then meets with young Muslim men known to have attended extremist mosques. More and more, it seems that Rauf is the critical link in the chain of a budding terror attack. An associate of Rauf's, Abdullah Ahmed Ali, buys a ticket to Britain from Pakistan later that June. By now, the surveillance of Rauf has expanded to his close associates, and it's believed that the two men are cooperating together on an as-yet-unknown terror plot against Great Britain. American surveillance on Al-Qaeda assets confirms that such a plot exists, but can offer few additional details. As Ali's baggage arrives in England, British police secretly open the luggage and discover packets of Tang, a powdered soft drink, and a large number of batteries. Immediately, the police become suspicious, and British lawmakers approve what will become the UK's largest surveillance operation, pulling in a total of 220 officers from Britain's various police, counterterrorism, military, and intelligence services. Another man, Asad Sarwar, also linked to Rauf and Ali, is then observed buying objects that seem to not fit his daily needs, and he's observed disposing of a large number of empty hydrogen peroxide bottles at a recycling center. Sarwar and Ali are then in a meeting at an East London park, and with evidence mounting, MI5 secretly enter Ali's apartment and discover what appears to be a homemade bomb factory. They covertly install cameras and microphones. By now, Al-Qaeda has publicly declared a threat to British aviation, and American intelligence sources confirm the veracity of the threat, though details and methodology of the suspected attack are as of yet unknown. For the British, it becomes clear that Ali and Sarwar have a hand in the plot to come, and their suspicions are confirmed when in August 3rd, Ali and another man, Tanvir Hussain, are filmed inside Ali's apartment constructing explosive devices out of soft drink bottles. The next day, British agents then monitor Ali as he spends 2 hours at an internet cafe, carefully researching international flight timetables. The target, it seems, is British flights headed to North America, with 5 US cities and 2 Canadian cities targeted. On August 9th, the British police spring their trap and arrest 24 suspects, including Sarwar and Ali. Among the suspects is an undercover British officer, which had infiltrated the group and warned authorities that an attack was imminent. As the investigation deepened, details of the plot began to come together, and an immediate ban on liquids aboard commercial flights was installed. Back in Pakistan, Rauf is arrested but found not guilty by a Pakistani court. He would be killed in 2008 by a US drone strike. So what exactly was the plot, and why are we now only allowed to carry just over 3 ounces of liquid on a commercial flight? The terrorist plot involved using soft drinks filled with acetone peroxide and hydrogen peroxide, which would be colored with tang to resemble a normal soft drink. Once aboard, the hydrogen peroxide would be injected into the acetone peroxide, and then a trace amount of a high explosive hidden inside a AA battery casing would be used as the explosive charge to detonate the main bomb. This charge would itself be detonated by linking the bottle of explosives to a light bulb and a disposable camera, with the flash from the camera triggering the explosion. The blast would have been large enough to tear open the fuselage of the Boeing 777s and Airbus A330s being targeted, which would have been done while the plane was on approach and over a crowded city. This would have dropped the plane from the sky, killing over 300 passengers aboard, while causing untold devastation on the crowded cities below, potentially killing hundreds more. In total, it's believed that if the plot had been successful and all targeted planes downed, the total body count would have been far greater than even the 9/11 attacks. Immediately after the plot was discovered and dismantled, the British and American governments forbade passengers from bringing liquids on board an aircraft, with many recognizing that this was simply unfeasible to maintain long term. Explosives and terrorism experts across America, Britain, and all the world began to test various liquid explosives in order to determine if any amount of liquid would be safe to allow back on a flight. At last, it was determined that 3.4 ounces of liquid represented the minimum risk to an aircraft or passengers, with a blast from this amount of explosive not being large enough to seriously damage an aircraft. While many claimed that terrorists could then simply bring aboard separate amounts of liquid explosives and combine them once airborne, it was determined by explosive experts that it would be impractical and not very realistic for the explosive liquids to be safely mixed into a working explosive compound. Rather, the terrorists would end up ruining the careful mix required or prematurely detonating a much smaller amount of the explosive, severely injuring themselves and doing little to no damage to the aircraft. Sadly, we live in a world of ever-evolving threats and people willing to exploit them to spread their agenda of fear and hatred. While no amount of regulation will ever be enough to keep you truly safe as you fly, governments around the world do the best they can to help keep terror plots at bay and ensure you land safely at your destination, even if it seems arbitrary and like a huge inconvenience to you at the airport. Think the liquid ban can really keep us safe in airplanes? Why or why not? Let us know in the comments, and as always, if you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe for more great content.